one, and they are very, very warm welcome to any CF Church service today. Hope you are doing well. Hope your family is doing well. And praise God, we can gather together today. For sure, we are not together physically, but spiritually, our minds and our thoughts and spiritually, we are connected. Because who connects us is the Spirit of God. And yes, praise God. Praise God. It's good to be back. It's good to be here today. And as I said, I hope you are well. I hope your family is well. I pray that you are enjoying the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the hope of Jesus, the fellowship with the Holy Spirit, and the expectation of what God is doing right now. Your life, your family, our life is in our families, in our community, and around the world. Hallelujah. God is God. He is powerful. When we think that nothing has happened, and sometimes people think, oh, God is not doing anything. God is doing amazing things in the quietness. God is moving. God is working. The Bible said that you work in the behalf of those who wait upon Him. And we wait upon Him. And He is our God. And He is in control indeed of our lives, the life of those who trust in Him. Praise God. And today I would love to do a reading as we are starting our service today. Yes, I pray that you are experiencing the joy of Jesus. But let's hear. Today I prayed for a passage and God gave me this passage for us. Isaiah 55 from 1 to 3. You have it in the screen. You can follow up what we are going to read. This is an incredible invitation. God is inviting us today. He said, come. Oh, you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on what doesn't satisfy? Listen. Listen to me and eat what is good. And you will delight in riches of fare. Give ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. This is what the Spirit of God really spoke to me today. Listen. Listen, this is a time that we need to tune our ears to what the Spirit of God is saying to us personally, what the Spirit of God is saying to our families, what the Spirit of God is saying to our church, what the Spirit of God is saying to our community, what the Spirit of God is saying to the whole world at this moment. We need to tune with God. We need to be very careful what we are tuning our ears with. You know, and the Bible invites us, if we hear the voice of our good shepherd, if we really hear what the Spirit is saying at this very moment, the Bible is promised us, listen, and then you eat what is good. Hallelujah. Give ear, and come to me, listen, that you may live. This is the invitation that God has for me and for you today. The only voice that you bring life, the only voice that you feed us, the only voice that you direct us in victory is the voice of our good shepherd. And I really pray that today we'll be listened. I really pray that we'll disconnect what is not, we shouldn't be connected, and we connect with the Spirit of God and we'll hear the voice of our God, His leadership, His guidance, and His direction for our own lives, for our families, for our church, and for this very moment. And shall we pray now? Let's pray. And also, we really want everyone who is connected to hear the message. Today, we have a guest speaker, Pastor Barry. He'll be ministering and bring the word of God for us. And we really want you to hear whatever God will be speaking through this service. And after the service as well, we want us, each one of us, to carry on, listen to the voice of our God. Amen? Let's pray. God, we thank you. We thank you for this beautiful day. God, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your greatness. We thank you for who you are. And oh God, we thank you for the kingdom that we are part, for the kingdom that you brought us in. And God, we thank you. We thank you for the amazing promises. We thank you for the invitation that is available for each one of us. We thank you because in the gospel is not about money. The invitation is for free, God. And we thank you for the blessings that has been poured over our lives. The free gift that has been given to us in Jesus Christ. And we praise you, God. We praise you because all these treasures is available for each one of us. And I pray that our ears will be open today, and then we'll be able to hear the voice of the Good Shepherd. We'll be able to hear the direction. We'll be able to hear, God, the words of encouragement, the words that you satisfy our soul today. In Jesus' name, God, we invite you in this time. We pray that your Holy Spirit will be moving among us, wherever our people are, in Portugal, in wherever people are at this moment, God, listen to this service. God, we pray for your touch. We pray that your Holy Spirit will be ministering. If there is anyone else we seek, God, we pray for the manifestation of your power. Father, we pray that the healing power of Jesus will be manifest over our bodies, and that the spirit of sickness will command it to go right now in Jesus' name. Go away in Jesus' name. Any sin that hasn't been confessed, God, we come before you. And we ask for forgiveness, God, for our sins and word and thought and attitude and behavior that hasn't glorified you, God. Forgive us in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, and we receive your forgiveness, and we invite you to come today and touch us and restore us and heal us and empower us and help us, Holy Spirit, to worship the Father. In Jesus' name, have your way, God. Have your way in our midst today. In Jesus' name, amen. And now we are going to have our amazing worship team coming, and please worship God. Do not get distracted. But worship God, engage with heaven today. And let's worship our Father. He's worthy of our praises. He's worthy of our worship. And let's give to the King of Kings the honor and the glory and the worship that he deserves. Worship team is with you.
Good morning, church. Let's worship together. Amen.
Water, you turn into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you.
Fuck up.
to stop us. And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Oh, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand His holy name. is unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
that together and say, open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Oh, Jesus, I want to see you. Oh, to see you. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Let's sing that again. Open. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. Jesus, you are holy, holy, holy. You are holy, holy, holy. Oh, you are holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. My soul cries, holy, holy, holy. My heart cries, holy, holy, holy. Oh, Jesus, you are holy, holy, holy. I want to see I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Oh, Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul.
Hallelujah. Praise be to our God. Hallelujah to the King of Kings. To you, O Majesty, we give you glory. And we really pray, God, have your way. Have your way in me. Have your way in my heart. Have your way in my mind. Have your way in my decisions. Have your way, God. Have your way in our families, God. Have your way in your church. Have your way in our nations, God. Hallelujah. Praise you. Praise be to our God. What a beautiful God we serve. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Bongai and Jonathan. What amazing, what anointed worship. Praise God. Hallelujah. We can carry on. So amazing. The presence of God is so real. The presence of God. I hope you are feeling the presence. I hope you are feeling the love, the embrace of our Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. What a beautiful God we have. Hallelujah. Big welcome to the Mutema family, Bongai's family. Welcome. It's good to know that you are connected with us. It's lovely. God bless you. And God bless everyone. Our friends from Valdemar and Luzia from Portugal. It's lovely. It's good to know that you are connected. Hope you are receiving. Amen. Thank you, God. And we carry on our worship and our praises. The time of the offering is a time also that we are giving to God, you know, what He has given us for us. He has given much more for us. And let's celebrate His goodness with our tithe and our offerings. And let's give. What God put your heart, give it. And we should give it generously. Amen. The number, the details is in the screen and the place. Thank you, God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the generosity of your people, God. We thank you because we have learned that a generous man, he'll be refreshed. And we have learned the kindness from our Father. And God, we thank you. We thank you for everyone who are able to give today. And Father, I pray that the same measure, you know, a good measure pressed down and transbordant will be given to every single person. And also, Father, for those who are not able to give, we know many people are struggling financially. And God, today we really pray. We really pray for our brothers and sisters. We pray for provision. We pray for miracles. I pray that your people are going to see the abundance of God, the provision of our Father over their lives, in Jesus' name. And Father, also, we really want to pray for our nation at this moment. We know so many families have lost jobs. So many families are struggling financially. God, we really pray that your goodness will be manifest over this nation today, God. We pray that you bring restoration over the economy of this nation. Father, I pray you are God of miracles. God, you can do much more. You made a nation to be born in one day, God. And you can change the economy of this nation in one day. And God, we really pray. We really pray for wisdom for our government, God. We pray for direction for the business. We pray for fresh ideas. We pray for revelation, Father. In Jesus' name, and I pray for your church at this time, God. I pray for the Christian people as well, God. I pray that you give them fresh ideas, new ideas for business, new ideas, God, to help this nation to come back, God, in their own feet. In Jesus' name, we pray for divine provision and we pray for miracles, God, at this time. And your name will be lifted high. Your name will be glorified. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. And our notices, as everyone knows, we carry on our Bible studies in our cell group. Has been really, really good to keep connected during the week. If you are not connected yet, please send your name for one of us, for Saul, for Ellie, or for one of the cell leaders. And we want you to be connected. We want you to be part of what God is doing at this very moment. Every Monday and Tuesday, we are getting together and we celebrate one another and we learn and we grow in God. It's a time to grow. It's a time to get stronger in our Lord. Amen. And the also prayer meetings, we carry on from 12 to 1. We are praying Friday after from 12 to 1. Every cell leader is getting together with their groups and praying Friday night from 7:30. We are praying. See, we are church that we love prayer. And we know prayers are powerful. There is no other way that we will overcome anything if it's not through prayer. There is no way that we can grow in God as well if you do not spend time in prayer. So let's pray. And also yesterday, NCF in Brazil and around the world, we are having the whole month prayers, 24/7. We are praying every day, and our day is Saturday from 3 to 4. Yesterday we had a lovely prayer time. We are connected with so many people in different places. It was awesome. We are doing it by Instagram. And if you want to get connected, please get connected with us. It's good. Prayer is good. And prayer is the only thing that is going to change the world, you know, is prayer. And we need to understand the weapon that God has given to us. And one of these weapons is prayer. Let's take it and let's use it and glorify our God and fight the battle in the proper way. And also this week, Saturday from 4:30, you know, we invite all the beautiful ladies of the church. We are going to have a meeting, and the Annalise will be leading it, and at 4:30, we are getting together to talk, to discuss, and to see how the lockdown is affecting us, how we are responding to the lockdown. It'll be a very formal meeting, and we'd love you to connect with us. I will encourage you to send your email to Annalise or to post your email address in the women's group, so then Annalise can send you the Zoom connection. And let's have fun on Saturday, 4:30, and let's talk, and let's laugh, and let's enjoy each other's company. Amen. And this is our notices. And also, today I have the privilege to introduce you to the new member of our family. We are so happy. We are so delighted to introduce new grandchild, Ayla Neve. You can see how beautiful, how cute she is. A gift from God, a present. We are over the moon as grandparents. We are so joyful for God's goodness. Can you see the beauty? Oh God, God is so good. Welcome, my beautiful princess. Welcome. God bless you. And may you fulfill your destiny and the plans that God has for your life. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. And also, brothers and sisters, we know this time is a time that as a church, we really need to stand. We need to stand for the kingdom. We belong to a kingdom. We are part of a kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, the everlasting kingdom, the kingdom of Jesus. And this is the time. We know Jesus is coming soon. I am telling you the signs, what you have seen. God, Jesus is coming soon. And we need to be ready. And also we need to prepare as John the Baptist. He came. He was the one who was preparing the way for Jesus to come as a baby. But now we at the church that you need to prepare for the second coming of Jesus Christ. And we need to position ourselves. And we need to fulfill the Great Commission. We need to preach the good news of the kingdom for our generation. And I want to encourage you, wherever you are, in your neighborhood, outside, use your media to influence people, to bring people to the way of Jesus Christ. We are here to influence people and to bring them to the place where they know there is a Lord who died on the cross, there is a Savior who forgives their sins, and there is hope for eternity. So let's be the voice for this moment. We are living a very dark moment, in a very difficult moment. But we are peacemakers, we are people of peace, and we are people who need to proclaim the good news of the kingdom for the lost. And as a church, we prepared this amazing leaflet. Can you see how beautiful it is with a lovely message, you know, and with the details of the church as well? And we, if you want some of this leaflet, send me a text message and I'll drop some in your house. And you can use it to do evangelism. You can use it to give to your friends or to your neighbor. And let's do, brothers and sisters, it's not time for us to be distracted. It's not time for us to be, you know, allowed to be distracted. It's our time to keep the focus. It's our time to keep our eyes on Jesus Christ and the purpose that He has for us. Let's make a difference at this time. The only hope for the world that you are living right now is Jesus. It's the Word of God and it's the Church of Jesus Christ. And you, me, we are the Church. And let's respond. Let's proclaim. Let's announce that Jesus is the hope. Jesus died on the cross to forgive people's sins. Amen. God bless you. And let's be the voice of hope. Let's be those who bring transformation. Let's be the peacemaker. Amen. And before I invite the preacher, I'd love to pray. I think it's good to pray. Let's pray for the nations right now. The Bible says the nations are in uproar. You know, there is storms around us. But you know the one who can calm the storm is Jesus Christ. And let's pray right now. Let's pray for this nation as well. Let's pray for peace. The peace of Jesus. The Bible says we do not need the peace of the world. We need the peace of Jesus because the peace of Jesus is the only thing that can make a difference. Amen. Let's pray right now where you are. Pray according to what the Spirit is telling you. Let's pray for this nation. But what we need to pray for is for peace right now. Father, we thank you. We thank you for Jesus coming and dying on the cross for each one of us. And God, we thank you because Jesus is the peacemaker. Jesus is the one who brought reconciliation. Jesus is the one who knocked the walls of separation, who broken the walls of separation. And yes, today we really pray, Jesus, that you come in our nations. You come in this nation, especially in England, that we are living here. We have been so blessed in this nation. And God, we really pray that your peace will be ruling over churches, over families, over the nation, over people's nations. God, we really pray that the kingdom of Jesus will be manifest. And the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ will be revealed for those who do not know the peace. In Jesus' name, God, have your way. Break the walls of separation and bring people together to know the love of God and to receive the salvation that is available for every human being. In Jesus' name, we honor you, God, and we thank you. Amen. And keep praying. Let's keep praying this week. Pray and pray and pray. Pray for the peace. Pray for our governments. Pray for the church, for wisdom, for the leaders of the churches. Let's pray that the new revelation, the revival that is come, I believe there is revival come. Soon there is revival and we need to be ready. It's the reason that I said, do not lose the focus because there is a great wave of a revival that is come and we need to be connected. We need to be in tune of what God is doing at this moment. Amen. And now I would love to invite Pastor Barry. He's a great friend of ours, and he's an incredible man of God, and he's the pastor of the Equipers Church in Colchester, and he's bringing the message for us today. Let's welcome Pastor Barry. God bless you, and listen to the message, and receive what the Spirit wants to say to you. Amen.
Hey, New Covenant Fellowship over there in Luton, it's so glad, it's such a privilege to be with you this morning. I'm glad I can play my small part in your journey. Do you know what? I see you guys as family. We've had a relationship for a long time now, and I just want to give some love and honor to your pastors, Enrique and Eva. I love you guys. You're amazing people. Just bless you, your family, your ministry, your health, your finances. You are amazing, and sending you lots of love. You guys have asked me to be part of your series of messages you're doing right now, and I've been given a passage to work with in Acts chapter 18 and verses 12 through to 28 with the thought process of how do we go about correcting a fellow believer when they're in the wrong. Tough subject you've given me, but the way I see things in terms of what is a good sermon invokes questions, invokes a wrestling with a topic, invokes discussion, and just creates an environment where we can build a whole and healthy picture. And I hope I invoke questions in you, I hope I create some wrestle in you, but I hope I can point you in what I believe to be the right direction. What I'd like to do is just to read the first chunk of that passage and miss out the middle bit, and the last chunk of that passage. In Acts chapter 18, I'm going to read from 12 to 17, and then I'm going to carry on from 24 to 28. Let me read it to you. Acts 18, 12 to 17, and then 24 to 28. It says this. While Gallio was proconsul of Achaia, the Jews of Corinth made a united attack on Paul and brought him to the place of judgment. This man, they charged, is persuading the people to worship God in ways contrary to the law. Just as Paul was about to speak, Gallio said to them, "If you Jews were making a complaint about some misdemeanor or serious crime, it would be reasonable for me to listen to you. But since it involves questions about words and names on your own law, settle the matter yourselves. I will not be a judge of such things." So he drove them off. Then the crowd there turned on Sosthenes, the synagogue leader, and beat him in front of the proconsul, and Gallio showed no concern whatever. Jumping down. Meanwhile, a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. He was a learned man with a thorough knowledge of the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately, though he knew only the baptism of John. He began to speak boldly in the synagogue when Priscilla and Aquila heard him. They invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. When Apollos wanted to go to Achaia, the brothers and sisters encouraged him and wrote to the disciples there to welcome him. When he arrived, he was a great help to those who by grace had believed. For he vigorously refuted the Jewish opponents in public debate, proving the scriptures that Jesus was the Messiah. Now, here we have two different situations, and I want to highlight to you straight away the contrasting outcomes. See, in the first section of that passage, we find the Jewish people looking at Paul and thinking, we're right, he is wrong, and we need to pull him down. So they bring him to this place of public judgment. And what's the outcome? No one wins. In fact, no judgment takes place, and they are so frustrated that a man takes a beating. Flip to the other side, you have here Priscilla and Aquila. Now, Priscilla and Aquila are a missionary couple who travel with the Apostle Paul and add weight and stability to his traveling mission. I love the names, Priscilla and Aquila. Can you imagine it? Oh, what are you doing tonight, Barry? Oh, I'm just hanging with Priscilla and Aquila. You know, they must be a really cool couple. But they're a missionary couple that travel with Paul. And they see Apollos speak. And they see him and they can see the gift on his life, but they can also see he's just missing the mark. He's not quite right. Now, the word sin, the definition of sin is actually missing the mark. So you know, you can make your own observations there, but he's just missing the mark on what he's saying. He's not bringing the whole picture. So what do? They privately invite him into a conversation. They engage with him with respect, and then they're able to show him the error of his ways and equip him for better service. What's the result? Well, the result is exactly what we just read in Scripture. Let me read it again. He was a great help to those who believed, and he vigorously refuted and debated the Jewish opponents on Scripture. You see, one scenario led to frustration and a beating, and the other scenario led to empowerment and greater ministry. I think right there is testimony and a message all on its own. You cannot be lost on you. Two different ways of handling your view of seeing someone in error. So if we are going to consider bringing correction to someone, it is essential that we first ask ourselves some questions. The first question I suggest you ask yourself is this: what is the goal? See, is the goal that you want to prove that you are right? Or is the goal to reposition someone for greater impact and a fuller life? Another question you need to ask yourself is the issue you are seeing even worth addressing? Is it worth correcting? Because you know what? Some things just need to be worked out by the individual over the course of time. You know, and it works itself out. And you don't need to fight a battle that's not yours. You know, the great Josiah of the Old Testament, he was a great man of God, but he died fighting a battle that he should never have been in. And sometimes I think we get all het up and frustrated about things that really don't matter, and they will work themselves out. So we don't need to be right about everything, we don't need to speak about everything, but some things do need to be addressed. So bear in mind this: if we are made for relationship, and we're made relationship primarily with God in an upright and then also a horizontal relationship with people, we are made for relationship. The thing is, you can be right at the top of your voice. You may well be right, and you might want to shout it from the rooftops and declare it and tell someone, and you can be right at the top of your voice, but end up disconnected and isolated because your goal was to be right, rather than to reposition someone for a fuller life. Can you see the slight difference? Is the issue worth losing the relationship over? Because what happens if you go to someone and they push back on you, and that's the end of it? So again, you have to ask yourself, is this issue worth addressing? How much does it really matter? Now, if the answer is yes, this is worth addressing, and yes, I feel strongly enough that I'm even prepared to lose the relationship, then we have to step in. You know, sometimes we look at someone and we can see the way they are living, the way they are thinking, the way they are speaking. It's just leading them to the edge of a cliff. You know, their life is going to implode, and we physically can't stand and watch it happen because we care too much. And so you feel like you have to step in. The goal there is that we're trying to reposition them, not to prove that we were right. I had a situation just over a year ago. In my church context, we had a guy who was in his 50s, joined the church. Lovely guy. He came in, he was full of passion. He joined a couple of serving teams. I thought, oh, what a great guy. He was full on in the praise and worship. He'd jump and clap. And it was a really great guy to have in church. But as we got to know him, you could start seeing some of the issues in his life. I found out that he had had 3 failed marriages, multiple children. When I was discussing with some of the girls at church how they felt about him, some of the feedback was, well, when we hug, it's a little bit too long and it feels a little bit creepy. And I could sense in him that he was carrying or affected by lust. You could see it all over him as you got to know him. Lovely guy, but he had this issue. 3 failed marriages, made the women feel uncomfortable. Eventually, he met this woman online. And he went off to her church a little bit, but we never got to see her at our church. And so I felt like, you know what? I care about this man so much, I feel like I should speak into the situation. Because if he doesn't deal with the issue of lust in his life, he's going to end up with a 4th failed relationship. And I care too much to let that happen. And I care even enough if it loses the relationship. Because if he has a relationship and it fails and I didn't speak up, I think that's worse. So I weighed up the pros and cons and I approached him. I said to him, could we have a meet? I'd love to chat to you. And he said, we can meet, but I want to bring my new lady. And I said, well, that's fine, but could I just speak to you first? Well, I got the mother of all emails telling me that I was the worst pastor in the world and I'd used him and I wouldn't be seeing him again and all these kind of things. And I think I'd shone a light on the right thing, and maybe that lust in his life was pushing back because it got found out. But he doesn't come to church anymore. But I still feel like I was trying to do the right thing because I love him and I wanted to reposition him for a better life. Now, I hope that relationship goes well. My feeling is, unless he addresses his issues, he will struggle at some point down the line. I hope you can see my point. And that's just one example where an issue is worth addressing, because I love the person, or you love the person enough to want to reposition them for a better life. It's worth asking these questions. So if you're deciding, yes, there's something in this person's world, their actions, and their words, their thought processes, and it's just like, this is not healthy, and I love them too much to keep watching it, you need to ask yourself the question, what gives you the right? Are you in the position to address the issue? And I want to suggest two things that are worth considering over that. And the first thing is the issue of respect. When you have someone's respect, it positions you in a place to speak from. It positions you in a place in their world that they may well listen to you. And hear this, just because you have a title doesn't mean you have the respect. For instance, you may have a boss at your workplace who has the title. They are your boss, they are your senior. But it doesn't mean they've got your respect, because you may look at the way they run their business, their life, and think, well, you might be my job, you may be my boss, you might have the title, but quite frankly, I don't respect you. And your opinion doesn't count for much for me. I'll do the job, I'll honour you in this context, but that's as far as it goes. My point being, title doesn't necessarily command respect. Respect is earned by the way you live your life and by the way people observe you, and it positions you then to speak in. When you look at 2 Corinthians and chapter 11, even the Apostle Paul, he goes to the Corinthian church and he needs to speak into a situation. Even the great Apostle Paul has to give a great long list of the things he's done, and the reason he's doing that is because he's winning their respect. He knows that unless he has their respect, there is no point in speaking in, because it will count for nothing. So even the great Apostle Paul knew that you had to have people's respect. It's true for you and it's true for me. Respect is earned and it positions you to be able to speak into someone's life. The other thing I think is worth considering in terms of having the right is relationship. See, when you are in a relationship, a strong and healthy relationship with someone, people know your heart, and they know that your heart is for their good. So when you're able to highlight, when you see an issue that is worth speaking into, they know the starting point is you love them and you want them to win. And so therefore they're much more likely to be open to correction, to be open to your thoughts, to be open to your words, because it came out of relationship. You know, I think for me, this is one of the strongest things in church life. It's accountability. You see, when you're in a church context, we know our starting point is we build our life on the rock. We have faith in Jesus, we have hope for the future, and we're called to do life together. And as we do life together, we start forming relationships, sure, with the leadership, but also with each other, where we start thinking, if you see something in me, please speak up, because I know you love me and I know you want the best for me. And it creates this place where two are better than one. You know, the counsel of many leads to a better life and better decision. Iron sharpens iron. We are better together. You know, there's loads of scripture all over the place saying relationship, relationship, relationship. And so one of the things in relationship is that we can be accountable to each other and therefore are able to bring challenge when we see things aren't right. That's healthy. Accountability breeds life. If there is no one in your world that you feel able to be accountable to, come on, you've positioned yourself wrong. There must be some people in your life that you can go to and say, please look at me. If you see I'm doing something wrong, saying something wrong, thinking something wrong, I give you permission to speak in and I will listen. You know, I'm a senior leader of a church, and yet I have many people that I say to them, you're ahead of me. You can mentor me. If you see I'm doing something wrong, I need you to speak in. Please speak in. Because here's the truth. No one gets it all right. No one's right about everything. No one makes the right call every time. And accountability brings health. So I have people speaking into my personal world. I have people speaking into the way I lead the church, the way I handle my finances. I'm allowing people to speak into me. Why? Because I know I don't get it right all the time. And that's just healthy. They love me, we have relationship, and they have my respect. So I say, please speak up if you see something. If you don't have someone you're accountable to, and you're listening to this right now, I encourage you. In fact, I implore you, get someone to be accountable to and say, I respect you enough and I know you love me. Please speak in. If you see something, I need you to speak in. It's just healthy. Can you see that? You see, when there is an issue now, and you feel like you need to speak in, it's an important thing. You've weighed up the pros and cons, you've weighed up your own motives, you've weighed up the potential loss of the relationship, and you still feel like I need to start to speak in here. It is best to do it. Matthew and chapter 5 and verse 9 from the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' great sermon. In the Beatitudes, he says this, Matthew 5 verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. And it doesn't say blessed are the peacekeepers. It says blessed are the peacemakers. And here's the difference. A peacekeeper will see that there's issues in people's lives and will avoid the issues to keep the peace. They'd rather not have the conflict and pretend everything's okay just because it keeps the peace. The reality is that is not genuine peace. It's not true peace. You can see the issue and you're avoiding the issue. So it's not real peace. It's just avoiding conflict. What a peacemaker does is become brave enough and loving enough to speak into the situation to make peace. Let's deal with this issue. Let's remove the issue from your world and from our relationship so that we can make peace. And look at what it says. They will be called children of God. What does that mean? People who are in God's family will be marked out by the way they are able to make peace. That means we're not afraid to bring challenge, but we bring a challenge out of love and out of the thought process to make someone's world better. And therefore, we can be called children of God because that's how God's family behaves. We are peacemakers, but we need to do it from the right heart. I hope you hear me. So how do we go about addressing an issue? Can I say three words? Gentle, gentle, gentle. You know, how many times has someone stepped into your world or into your life and just been too aggressive, too officious, too self-righteous, just too hard? And it's almost impossible to receive the rebuke or the correction or the different thought process. It almost makes you want to dig your heels in and go, no, you're so harsh to me, just back off. It never seems to bring the hoped for outcome. It just makes people push back. But then when we look at scripture on how it tells us to address issues, I'm going to read two scriptures to you. Look at the difference. The first one is Galatians and chapter 6 and verse 1. Galatians 6, 1. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, if someone's missing the mark, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. You see, I love that. Can you see the language? It's restoring someone. The goal is to reposition someone for better life. The goal isn't to be right. The goal is to help someone's life be repositioned in a place where it's going to be fuller and flow better and more joyous and just full of love and peace. That's the goal. But look at this. Watch yourselves. It's not like none of us could get it wrong. Watch yourselves. Don't go in there thinking, I've got it all sorted. Go in there with respect, and it brings humility to the table that says, I know I don't get everything right, but I love you enough. I've seen something. Would you consider this? This is how I view it. Can we have a conversation? Look at Priscilla and Aquila. They brought him, Apollos, into a private place and had a discussion. Didn't blurt it out to everyone else. Come on, let's talk, because I can see something. I hope I can highlight it to you. I hope I can be gentle enough so that you would hear me. And I know that I don't get it all right, but I'm also doing my best. Can you see the difference? That this just creates a forum of discussion and revelation and points people back to Jesus. And here's another one in the second book of Timothy, 2 Timothy 2 and verses 24 to 26, and this is in the New King James Version. It says this: "And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient, in humility correcting those that are in opposition. If God perhaps will grant them repentance, so that they may know the truth, and that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive to him and to do his will." Can you see the language again? Gentle, humility, repositioning. Can you see this language? This is biblical language of how we bring correction. Gentle, 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 humility, with the goal to reposition you. I love you enough to point you back to Jesus. I love you enough to highlight this thing. Please hear my heart. Can you see the difference? There they were with Paul. "We're taking you to court. We're making a big noise about it. You're wrong. We're right. Let's take him in front of the crowd." And what did it cause? No great outcome. Someone got beaten up. It never worked. It's never kind. It's never pleasant. And there's no love attached to it. But the Bible talks about humility and gentleness and relationship and repositioning people for a fuller life. I hope I'm building a picture for you to think through, to talk through, to work through in your own world. Gentleness, humility, with a goal to reposition someone for life. See, we live in a world that has so much gossip in it. You know, our most viewed TV programs are the soap operas. And the soap operas rely on gossip. It all revolves. You look at I don't know if you're a soap opera person, and I'm not, but you may be. But here's the thing. If you took out the gossip in Coronation Street, in EastEnders, in any of these places, there would be no show. Yet the world wants to gossip. The world wants to talk about people. You know, "Oh, did you see how so-and-so behaved? I'm shocked. I just can't believe they did that. Did you hear what so-and-so said? Oh, he got that totally wrong. It's terrible, don't you?" The world talks about people, but the word says go to people. The world and gossip talks about people, but the word of God says go to people. Look at this here in Matthew 18, verses 15 through 17. "If your brother or sister sins, if they miss the mark, go and point out their fault, just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or tax collector." Can you see the progression here of biblical correction? If you see something and you love someone enough to want to point it out and reposition them, and that's your goal, go to them. Go straight to them. Don't talk about them. Go to them and have a discussion. A discussion based on gentleness and love and humility and a heart to want to see them win. If they don't get it and you are convinced you're right, speak to someone else, someone who you know that person will respect, giving them a position to speak into, and take them along and say, "We need to revisit this conversation. Please hear us. This person agrees too," and continue the conversation. If they still won't hear you, it says, bring them to the church. Now, I don't think that means put them up front in church in front of the whole congregation and air their dirty laundry. I believe it means take a leader. Take someone who's senior in church, who knows the scriptures, who has the respect, and take them in and have the conversation again. And the hope there is they will acknowledge the thing that is wrong, or the way they're behaving that is wrong, and correct it. And it's done in gentleness, in privacy, and in love. If then they won't see what is going on still, it says this: treat them like the pagan. Now hear this. The pagan is welcome in church. I hope all pagans come to church. All unbelievers come to church. We want to see them in church. Why? Because they might meet Jesus in that context. They might get in the worship and the Holy Spirit might land on them and, wow, that softened my heart. They may hear a great message, or someone may have a conversation over a coffee with them that just changes their world. We want them in the building. So it isn't about excluding them. But what it's saying here is, we've wrestled this issue 1-to-1, 2 and 3-to-1, with the church and one, and you're still not seeing it. So you are welcome here, but you don't have a voice here. Please come, you are welcome, but we're not debating this anymore. We've proven to you through our heart, our love, our wisdom and scripture, it's no longer a debate. And so please come, but you don't have a voice. Do you see the difference? We don't want to hear you rattling on and talking about this, that and the other. That's not welcome here, but you're welcome here. And that way we can just create a healthy environment where people can find their way back to Jesus and be healed and restored. Because Jesus said, I came that you would have life and life in its fullness. And that's what we're fighting for. If someone's not living the fullest life, because previously it says the thief comes to steal, kill and destroy, something is robbing them. That's the issue. The person's not the issue. That's the issue. And so we address the issue to bring the person back into the fullest life. And that's what we fight. It's worth fighting for. That's why we need to be peacemakers. But all underpinned with this heart of humility and gentleness and love and wanting the best for people. It's just a completely different way of looking at these situations than the world would look at these situations. I hope you're hearing my heart. Here's just a couple of practical thoughts. You know, not everyone is the same. People respond differently. So for me, the best leaders of people have the ability to communicate and address issues in different ways for different people. You know, the Apostle Paul says, be all things to all men. We need to be able to communicate in all kinds of different ways so that people can understand the message. And that's true in life too. You know, most of you may well know that I play professional football, and I learned so much in terms of leadership and man management through that process. And I believe, looking back on it, God was doing something on the inside of me then to position me for what he's called me to now. And so I played under various different managers, and some of them were too gentle, some of them were too harsh, and some of them just got it right. I remember a time when the manager came in and we were losing a game that we should have been winning. We weren't playing well. And he came in at half time and he got the trays of our cups of tea, and he went around every player and he went up to the goalkeeper and said, you're having a nightmare game, and threw the cup of tea in his face. Hot tea. He went up to the defender and said, well played, you're doing a good job. He went up to the centre back, threw the cup of tea, you're not playing well enough. And he went around the team in front of everyone, totally humiliating players. Now, for some of the guys, they went out in the second half and thought, I'm going to prove him wrong. I'm going to play better. And it really stoked them up to do better. But for some of the guys, it totally destroyed them because they were humiliated in front of their peers. And when they went out in the second half, they didn't play better. They played worse because they felt humiliated and all their confidence had drained from their body, and they almost just couldn't do what they're gifted to do. And so my point is this. Some people just need an arm around them and a gentle point in the right direction. Some people, it is the most loving thing to do to say, come on, this isn't right. Let me show you why it's not right, and this needs to stop. And some people, that's the best language. But the goal as a leader or as someone who cares enough is to think, what is best for this person? My goal isn't to be right. My goal is to reposition this person for a better life. And so what language should I be using? Because not everyone responds the same. Do they need the cup of tea in the face? Or do they need an arm around the shoulder to say, come on, we can do better than this? But the language can be different for different people, and great leaders know which is which. But overarching all of those responses, it's gentleness, gentleness, gentleness. It's based on love. It comes out of relationship and respect, and it comes from a heart that says, I love you too much not to speak up. I have to make some peace in your life, so I need to speak in. So I hope all of this gives you some food for thought. I hope it gets you questioning. I hope it causes you to look and analyze your own life and the way you speak and address issues. I hope even you might consider, is there places in my world where actually I'm missing the mark? Doesn't mean you're the worst person in the world, but is this an opportunity to think, okay, do I need someone to come and speak to me? Or God, do you need to highlight it for me? Because you know, one of the roles of the Holy Spirit is to convict us of sin. And so the Holy Spirit comes in and you can say, search my heart, O Lord. And he will. One of the bravest prayers anyone can pray. Search my heart, Lord, and see if there's any unclean thing. Because you want to have a pure heart. Because God loves a pure heart and clean hands. And so the concept is, search yourself. And then if you're doing your best and you still miss the mark, give someone an opportunity to speak into your world because they love you enough. Not to prove you wrong and prove themselves right, but to position you for the fullest life that Jesus came for. And that creates a healthy church where people flourish, knowing that none of us gets it right all of the time, but we love each other enough to point out areas where we could be improving. So pray about it, think about it, create great accountability relationships, but love each other with gentleness and humility, but pointing everyone to Jesus. I hope that's helpful to you. It's been my privilege to play a small part in the journey, cheering you on. Let's stay connected. You know, we might not be meeting in the same building, but technology is so, so good. We're almost more connected than ever. Bless you all. Pastor Barry signing out.
Wow, what a great wisdom. Thank you very much, Barry. Thank you for allowing God use you to bless us, to bring this very practical and amazing message. I hope you have been blessed. And there is always an opportunity for us to grow. You know, and this is the reason that we are studying the book of Acts. We are doing this series in the book of Acts to learn the way how the early church dealt with every details, relationships, how to correct our fellow brothers. And it's amazing. Thank you very much, Barry. Thank you once again. Thank you. And for you, brothers and sisters, I hope you have learned, you know, to be accountable, to deal with the challenge in love, to correct our brothers in love, not to run away, but to face the situation in kindness and with the love of God. That's awesome. That's amazing. Bless you. God bless you. And we are coming to the end of our service today. But before, I would like to pray again. I would like to pray for you guys. I would like to pray for relationships, you know. If there is any issue in your relationship, and if they, as Barry said, you know, the Spirit of God is the one who brings conviction into our hearts. And I think it's a good opportunity to ask God right now, God, search my heart. Let's get you right with God. You know why? Because what is come for us now? We need to be right with God, but we need to be right with one another. With a broken relationship, we will not be able to experience what is available for us, what heaven will be manifesting over our lives. And I think it will be good right now to pray. If there is anyone else, if there is any relationship that you need to be addressed, I think it's good to go address and be humble, you know, and they do in the right way. And for the future as well, I think you have learned the lesson today, how to deal with our brothers and sisters in love and kindness. Let's pray now. Father, I thank you for this incredible message. We thank you for the wisdom that was brought for us today, God, and also for practicality for our relationships. Father, we thank you. We thank you because you are God who teach us every small detail of our life. It really matter for you, God. And I thank you. I thank you for today. And also, I want to bless my brothers and sisters today, God. I pray that your Holy Spirit will give them grace. I pray for humility for each one of us, God. We'll be able to acknowledge we are not right all the times. We'll be able to allow people to come into our lives and correct us, God, and to bring us back into the right track. In Jesus' name, we stand against the spirit of independence. In Jesus' name, we are not independent. We depend on God and we need each other to come into our lives and to help us. In Jesus' name, God, I pray for every marriage. I pray for every relationship today. We pray for wisdom, how this relationship, how to restore this relationship, God. In Jesus' name, bless your church today. And I really pray that you not be peace who keep the peace, people who keep the peace, but you will be the peacemaker. Help us, God, to manifest the peace of Jesus and to help our brothers and sisters to grow in you. We thank you for today. And we bless as well our friends who are visiting us today, God. We thank you for their lives. We bless them. We bless their families. We release over their lives right now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. We release over your life today, over your families, over your relationships. And wherever you go, may God help you to be the peacemaker, the one who restores bridges, the one who restores relationships, the one who shows the love of God wherever you go. Have a blessed week. Have a fruitful week. And remember, proclaim the good news of the kingdom. Make Jesus too big to ignore. I love you and I bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.